Hey folks, so it's me. I'm talking. I'm Mike. I'm the audience development associate here at Dixon Place. Just want to welcome you guys. Thank you guys so much for being patient with us. We did have some folks who were having some difficulty getting in from the waiting room. We do have most people on board now, but I'll continue to let people in as they arrive. So welcome once again. Thank you guys so much for joining. I can't see most of you guys, but hopefully you guys could all see me and hear me very well. So a little bit of about Dixon Place. I feel like a lot of folks here are familiar. I'm seeing some waves. Thank you so much. So Dixon Place, we are a nonprofit performing arts organization. I've been around for some 35 years, and we have our space on the Lower East Side, which pre-COVID would be packed with 15 or so live performances a week, theater, dance, performance art, burlesque, puppetry, all different combinations of those things. At least since March of last year, we've been kind of been meeting here in this space. I'm very grateful for that opportunity nonetheless. Everyone seems to have been really good about playing nice on Zoom, but just to keep things running as smoothly as possible, I'm gonna give a little bit a few general instructions. So for this first part, we're gonna ask everyone to keep themselves on mute. And we'd prefer folks keep their video off, at least for now. Close to the end, we'll have an opportunity for everyone to kind of open up their video and turn their microphone on, and for us to all kind of to chime in and speak. So that's it. So we will try to help as much as possible, but for the best viewing experience, we recommend folks try to watch it in a speaker view. And so for folks who are familiar with that, that would be that icon on the top right hand of your screen if you're using a computer, where it says view, and you could just switch over to speaker view. It might be different for folks who are listening from their iPod or their phone, and it might just be swiping to that screen. That is pretty much it. Again, we so much appreciate you joining us. We've been looking forward to doing this show. So the team at Concrete Temple are some of our absolute favorite people to work with. And I've been doing that with them, working with them for a few years now. And so we're just always impressed by the kind of work and just their tenacity to keep making work during this kind of what could be a rather difficult time. So with that, I'm gonna start winding down my portion of this evening, and I'm gonna start kicking things over to some of the team at Concrete Temple. Carlo, if you're out there, go ahead and unmute yourself. I'm gonna introduce you to a member of the Concrete Temple team, Carlo, who's gonna share about the company and a little bit about what's going to happen tonight. I'll see you guys at the end. Thank you again so much for joining us, and thanks for being here. Carlo, you could take it away.
I'll take it away. Thank you, Mike. Hi, everybody. I'm Carlo Adinolfi, one of the co-artistic directors of Concrete Temple Theatre. Renee Philippi is the other co-artistic director. About 15 years ago, Dixon Place and Concrete Temple Theatre started leading workshops at Surovich Senior Centers in theatre. And we've done it now. We've had two workshops every year for the past 15 years. When COVID hit, and these workshops would culminate in performances at Dixon Place. So we'd work at Surovich, create plays with the seniors, and then it would all culminate with a performance at Dixon Place. This spring, we moved everything on to Zoom so that we could keep working. This re most recent development, the childhood fascinations, that was the theme. We started in October, and we had a slightly larger group, but some people had to drop out. But we now have nine people who are going to show their work tonight. They have all created the work. It's all original work that they've created, and you're in for a great surprise. I think you'll really enjoy it. So thank you again for coming, and enjoy the show.
Jane, and I'm from the South. My owner bought me from an auction in South Carolina. I'm happy I'm here and have a special place in the corner of my owner's shelf. I'm the oldest, and I had a few problems with the others. They seemed to be jealous of my long braids. They should be fixed a little, but my owner has no time. I think I'm pretty, and people remark about me when they come here. I just keep my place in the corner. I think I'm missing a shoe, but my dress covers it up. There's a new boy doll that came here. He's too young and too short for me, but I feel there'll be some stirring up, especially by Doris, who feels she's the most beautiful. I'm Nancy, and I stand in the corner of my owner's shelf, right on the back front that houses all of us. I was adopted from Germany by her friend Nancy, which is where I got my name. I'm happy here. Kind of like my spot on the shelf, but sometimes I moved around. I really hope she doesn't move me. Sometimes I tilt a little in the corner, but it's restful. I shouldn't say this, but I think I'm the prettiest. I am the only blonde, at least from what I can hear. I have one other, let's call her a sister doll on the shelf that may be in her own way very pretty. Her outfit's beautiful and I don't know where she came from. I'll find out one day when the visitors talk. I think she's older, or I'd say she looks older. I never seem to age, but I really know I'm getting older. Still, I don't change. One other one has annoyed me, though, and she is Jane. She's the oldest, and I think she's favored. She has a way of demanding more attention. When others come in and discuss or observe us, she always gets more notice or comments about her. I'm sure, though, when I feel that I'm confident, I can feel I can hold my own. My owner's nice, but she runs here and there. I'm not sure they really understand her, but she will watch over us in the long run. I don't go from place to place like the others. This has been my only home. But it's Doris that bothers me. She's two spots down. She has a way of demanding attention. I think it's the look in her green eyes. Sometimes she's picked up and dusted a bit. Not me. I seem just to stand here. I dread leaving the top shelf. I think I'm too tall for another shelf anyway. At least I hope so. I guess I should be happy and stay where I am. I don't think I'll grow. I'm center stage, right in the middle of the top shelf. I was adopted, but I don't know from where. I don't know who my real family is. I have a beautiful red dress and a bow in my hair. People who visit and come and see me remark about how pretty I am. When they ask where I'm from, my caretaker says she doesn't remember. This bothers me. I let it go. I know she cares and it kept me all these years. I'm not as old as the others, but I appear mature looking. I have dark hair also. Right now I have a dilemma. There's a boy doll. I think one of the very few here, and he lives on the shelf right below me. I don't know his real name. He's a newcomer. He's only been with us for less than a year. He's so adorable. I have a terrible crush on him. I'm hoping in some way I can be moved to the same shelf. I'm wondering how that could happen. I wish I could talk to people. I hear people talking about him. He looks Scottish or English. I remember when he came to live with us. Recently, a woman remarked about him, but his name was not mentioned. He was taken off the shelf and held in some visitor's hand. I got a glimpse of him and fell in love. I am the only boy here on the shelf. I am only here for about 4 months, the newest kid on the block. I'm trying to adjust. I came from a shop somewhere nearby, and I'm glad I was adopted and taken somewhere. I was on display, and it seemed like nobody wanted me. Then along came this lady who seemed to really like me. Now I have a new home. I'm on the second shelf at this very nice place. I seem to like who adopted me. So far, I think she really likes me. After all, I'm a special. I'm the only boy. I know there are all girls above me and some little ones below me. I am not sure what they are looking like. I do know the ones above me are really pretty and definitely my type. I was shown to a neighbor, and then she remarked about the girl above me. My caretaker removed her from the shelf with some others, and wow, what a beauty! The others were okay, but she was special. I just wish I was on the top near. I think her name is Doris. The problem is, as I notice, that the owner is a little bit all over the place. It doesn't seem to complete one thing. Quite amusing, but nice. Alone, she goes here and there and doesn't seem to concentrate too much on us, except for introducing us to a stranger. But time will tell. I heard her say her place was going to be painted soon. I wonder if that means we'll be moved. What will it mean for us? Will we all stay positioned in the same place? Will I live on the second shelf forever? Where am I going? Where is she taking me? Where is what she doing? I hope and pray I get off the shelf, maybe somewhere near Doris. Should I kiss her?
Blue night carpet, where are you following me? Pure and soft, big white clouds intricately woven into the dusky sky. Luminous moon, as the old tired weaver, her fingers scorched and twisted, bent in perpetual frozen motion of holding that magical thread forever. Suspended in lifeless animation, big round moon's head falls heavily upon her chest. This ancient weaver works hard and never sleeps. She weaves and embroiders giant carpets of the sky with blinking falling stars and the sun so radiant and haughty. Tumbling stars the weaver quickly catches and adds to the carpet's flaming lights. The work this weaver does is laced with love and affection, putting all heart into the work of her tired bluish hands. Embroidered flowers planted into deep rows over spheres clouds grow from seed smiles and perpetual sweet blessings of the gardener. The golden-threaded rays of sun carried in beaks of birds to shed light give new life of the vast expanse of heaven. The day has been long, the night still longer. Deep, heavy tiredness falls on the weaver, and she begins to run and run through infinite fields of her dreams. Her heart, flapping its wings, sees a dormant master, quietly pushes open just a slot of a cage door, and out it flies, lifted on sweeping magnitude of the old weaver's visions into the unknown, it disappears. Forgot the exhausted moon to call in her roaming heart, lock it in the little secret chest on her being, as she is done regularly. The heart, inflamed with care and desire, overwhelmed with curiosity for the outside world, sneaks out, and off it goes. And so the frivolous heart of the weaver begins exploring a dark, heavy night's carpet. As it rolls, diving in and out between rows of yarn, it eventually gets stuck, entangled in one of the loopholes. That's where the aged weaver finds it at sunrise upon awakening, feeling very empty, without any warmth, excitement, and devotion to her work. She grabs her chest, at that moment discovering her heart is gone. The tiny doors to the sacred compartment upon her breast wide open. She knows immediately something is very wrong. Off the weaver goes to wander through the carpet, losing herself in its deep paths of blossoms, plants, and mysterious animals weaved with such affection and infinite patience. They are calling to her in different voices, for they know her, and she understands them. Suddenly, something shiny, spreading enormous warmth, peeks out, half hidden along the path. Well, that is the heart. And back it goes, where it belongs, to continue its work. Helping the weaver spread sunshine, weave it into fluorescent fields, creating exotic animals and winged inhabitants of the azure. Weaver's devotion and servitude in caring for her task continue to shine through radiant colors of knitted yarn of the heavenly maker. You, out there, gazing up and about, carefully eyeing depths of the sky, please do try, if you pass it by, to catch a curious rolling heart of an old weaver if it happens to escape.
Watch me, world. I can do anything. I'll bet I'm going 100 miles an hour. No one can stop me now. Oh no. I can't stop. Ring. Help.
Bang. Crash. Hey, Blue. Good to see you. Looking good. I'm glad Doc put you back together again.
Oh, thank you, dear. I'm feeling so much better. How's Sally doing?
Doc said she'll be in bed for the rest of the summer. She just takes too many chances. Last week, I'm in the boat with her, and she's rowing away, totally unawares that there's a hole the size of a donut at the bottom of the damn thing, and the water's coming up, and I'm swimming in it, and all she can say is, "We're going swimming, we're going fishing," and I'm trying to tell her that I'm drowning. Luckily, it started to pour, and we had to go back to the dock. You think she's got a death wish?
Oh, I don't think so, dear. She's just a child. Children can be careless. I'd like to tell you about our accident, but you're too young to hear all the gruesome details.
Are you kidding me? In dog years, I'm 41.
Well, if you insist. Last Wednesday, she packs up her beach blanket and towel and some snacks, and we head out for the lake to go swimming. It's a beautiful day. The sun is shining. We take a left turn at the corner, and she starts speeding down that steep hill. She's standing, and she breaks me. Much too fast, much too hard, and we hit a giant boulder, and she goes head first over the rock, and I, well, you saw me when the neighbor carried me into the garage. I was off my axle.
Yeah, your front fender was shot, you had fractures in five of your spokes, and your chain guard was missing. Your basket looked like a modern art sculpture.
And I kept ringing my bell. Ring, 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 ring. Then Alfred, that hunky neighbor, drove by and saved the day.
Yeah, that owl is a superhero.
Yes, but he's not a gentleman. He grabbed me under my saddle and pinched me. I screamed, but I guess humans can't hear us. Doc told me that I'm suffering from PTSD.
What's that?
Post-traumatic stress disorder, dear.
Yeah, whatever. I'm here for you if you need to talk. You know, since Sally broke a leg, she's been very lonely. She can't go riding or swimming with her friends. So I'm working overtime to keep her company. She's been reading out loud to me.
Out loud? Oh, dear. What's she reading out loud?
She keeps reading the same book over and over again. I practically have it memorized.
Gosh, it must be a very interesting book if she keeps reading it over and over again. What's it about?
I guess you could call it an adventure story.
You mean like Treasure Island, dear?
Treasure Island? Now, that's a real adventure. That book starts out kind of tame, and then it gets really weird. It's about this girl, Alice, who falls down a rabbit hole and goes through one scary thing after another. She has all these near-death experiences and drinks weird stuff and gets bigger and smaller. And then, just when she's at her wit's end, oh, Sally must be reading Alice's Adventures in Wonderland to you, dear. My gran used to read it to me when I was just a three-wheeler. That damn book has given me nightmares. Last night, my dream, I fell down a rabbit hole. I was attacked by a tabby cat the size of a cow. A mean cook tried to hit me over the head with a frying pan. And a man wearing a top hat tried to cut my hair. You know how I hate having my hair cut.
Bye.
Don't look now, dear, but Sally is staring at us. Maybe you should play dead.
Boy, come in now. I'm on the last page of my wonderful book, and I want you to listen to the very end of it with me. When we're all finished, I'll give you some treats.
Doesn't she know I've heard the end of that book a million times? But let's face it, for treats, I'll do almost anything. Woof, woof.
Oh, the things we do for love. Love of treats. Come see me later, dear. It gets lonely out here on the fence. Oh, I've missed you. Come sit with me. You know how I love to read to you.
Woof, woof. Hold your tongue, said the queen, turning purple.
Oh, yes, I remember that, boy. The queen almost fainted when she turned purple.
I won't, said Alice. Off with her head, the queen shouted at the top of her voice.
I was frightened to death, boy, when she said that. And nobody moved. Then I could see how papery she was. Who cares for you? Said Alice. Then I grew back to my full size boy. You're nothing but a pack of cards, I said.
Woof, woof.
But that's not the end. I'll pour the tea. Help yourself to some tarts and treats. Woof, woof. Time is such a curious thing. What happens when you come to the beginning again? Don't overthink it, dear. Your life has just begun. Woof, woof.
I'll need to leave extra time to get over to the hospital tomorrow. The snow can make travel dangerous, and the other volunteers may not be able to get there for the holiday party. Clayton is expecting me to read his favorite animal adventure story about flying and birds. The whole pediatric cancer team are planning to be there, and I wouldn't want to arrive late. Funny. Oh, that old fantasy resurfaced of when I was a child back in the Bronx. Haven't thought of it in years. About birds and flying and what they saw and thought and how they felt. And of God. And where God fit in my world. And now, how I wish I could make things better for little Clayton and all the children.
Don't forget to help your mother with the dishes.
I won't. Mom said she's giving me a break today. Aww. I'll begin. Just like I practiced. I'll fly like a bird. I can be a little sparrow or a pigeon or a big hawk. Yeah, I could scare people too. I can rule the world. Hawk, hawk, hawk. I'll stretch my arms out really wide and close my eyes really, really tight. I want this more than anything in my whole life. Even more than those bright new roller skates I saw in the window, and even more than the baby kitty I taught to potty in the hole I dug in the backyard. Kitty kept a promise. She did a poop and buried it. Dad wouldn't let me keep her. He was mean. Up on the bed, at the tippy end here. Okay, eyes shut tight. It won't work if I peek. Not even a little. Need to concentrate. Ow! Don't worry, Dora. Ouch. We'll do it again. Don't fall off this time, okay, Dora? Here I go. Balance. Balance.
Let's go!
I'm flying!
Come fly with me. Let's fly.
Wow.
Let's fly away.
We're high above gray cement yards and jutting fire escapes. Cooking odors, music, and kids playing. Johnny on the pony, stickball, jump rope, yelling and screaming. Oh, there's Yankee Stadium and the Bronx Zoo. Oh, there's my friend Elizabeth and her new baby sister.
Wait a second. What's that little sparrow doing down there?
That's where I eat lunch.
I'd like to be a bully for a change, just like I've been bullied.
I think I'll have a little fun. So, what do you think you're doing on my bench? You're not allowed here. This is reserved for the big guys. Hawk! I'm a lot bigger and richer than you, little sparrow. I can take your food and eat your young and make you feel small, even smaller than you are.
Yes, I am sure you can do all those things. But I think I am richer than you and kinder. To be a little sparrow who makes it through harsh New York City winters and sweltering summers and finds food and looks cheerful in spite of it and works very hard along with others and is grateful for what we have and doesn't think we are better than any other birds makes us feel fulfilled and rich. Besides, we're cute.
You've given me some things to think about. Sounds like there's some kind of higher power. Or maybe it's a combination of that and your will and courage?
You look thirsty. Would you like me to get some water for your journey? We always remember to count our blessings and give thanks for what we have, though it may sometimes be very little.
I think I'll be on my way now. Is that what God is like?
Dora? Dora! Your mother's made dessert!
Dessert? I'll be right there. Hello? Oh, hi. Hi, Ella. I just finished my dinner dishes. I'll see you tomorrow, okay? We'll help decorate the tree first, okay? I'll bring my baked apple pie. Apple? Uh-huh. At 2. The sweater is ready. Just needed to redo a section. Uh-huh. Birds. Birds! On the front! Okay. Thanks, Ella. See you then. You too. Drive safely.
All of her days have gone soft and cloudy. All of her dreams have gone dry. All of her nights have gone sad and shady. She's getting ready to fly. Fly away. Fly away.
Once upon a time, in a tall tower at the tip of an island, there lived a small girl. Like many small girls, she did ordinary things. She played with her dolls and watched cartoons on TV and helped her mother with the housework. But the small girl was born in the year of the dragon, which is the only mythical creature in the Chinese zodiac. Like many dragons, she was meant to do enchanting things, but she did not know it yet. One busy afternoon, after making sure that her dolls were content, she went to look for her mother who was watching TV. There in the living room, she saw the most marvelous sight. On the TV, these magical people were moving across the room. They were dressed oh so beautifully and moved together and seemed to know just what the other one was going to do. They swirled around the room and then up and down the furniture. And they made the most amazing sounds with their feet. Tap, tap, tap. She had never seen anything like it. She knew instantly that this is what she was supposed to do. She started to move around the room in time to the music. Then she heard her mother say, "Oh dear, can't you ever sit still?" So the young girl sat down, very still. But she knew she had to find these magic powers of moving. After that, whenever she was by herself, she tried to move like they did in the movie. Then she tried to teach her dolls how to move also. One day her mother saw her. "What are you doing? Dancing? How silly." "So that is what it is called," the little girl said to herself, "dancing." She decided that when no one was looking, she would dance. She danced while her mother made supper. She danced while her father read the newspaper. No one except for her dolls knew that she danced. One day, as she was dancing around the living room, her mother walked in unexpectedly. "Listen, you silly child," her mother said. "People don't dance in real life. People only dance in the movies. Now stop jumping around the house. I wish you would learn to do something serious for a change." The little girl walked away sadly. Her mother did not understand. Her father did not understand. They loved her, but they did not know that she was a dragon. She did what so many little girls do when they can't be who they are. She took her dancing and wrapped it up in a tiny bundle. She called for her fairy Godzilla protector to take the dance bundle and bury it in a big fluffy cloud where it was safe and no one else could find it. Then the little girl pretended that it did not exist. Like many little girls, she did her homework and played games and had birthdays and graduations. And she grew and became a lovely young woman who had a job and friends, but always looked a little sad. Meanwhile, her fairy Godzilla was looking out for her. The fairy Godzilla was the protector for several dragons who forgot who they really were. So he knew what to do. One very quiet night, soon after her 21st birthday, the young woman dreamed she was sitting in the subway, reading a book, when suddenly the most magnificent dragon got up from his seat and started to tap dance. How astonishing, she thought. She wanted to speak with him, but he exited at the next stop. The following morning, on her way to work, she saw in the newspaper that a tap dance show was happening that day. The young woman first thought, "I shouldn't go. It's silly. I should do the laundry or pay my bills or do something practical this evening." Then she heard a sound. Tap, tap, tap. She wasn't sure where it came from, but she did see a rather large creature exit the train at the next stop. So that evening, the young woman entered the most magical of places. Here people danced and twirled and made all sorts of tapping sounds with their feet. And she wanted to do that too, but she didn't know how. "Come dance with us," the people said. "You know how. Just dance what you know to be true." So, trembling with fear, she put one foot in front of the other and started to move the way she did so long ago when she was a little girl. And suddenly, she felt like she was dancing on the big fluffy cloud, and she knew who she was at last. And she danced happily ever after.
Anthony wanted to be a mountain, to see how it felt to be that big. So at night, when he said goodnight, he wished with all his might to be a mountain. Anthony wanted to be a fish and swim across a giant ocean. So the next night when he said goodnight, he wished with all his might to be a fish. Anthony wanted to be a bird, to fly high in the sky and into the clouds. So at night, when he said goodnight, he wished with all his might to be a bird. And there he was, a bird. And there, next to him, was another bird. "Let's fly away," Anthony said, "higher than the sky." "Oh, but we're birds that can't fly." What kind of bird can't fly?" "The beautiful, rare, orange-footed booby. That's what we are." Anthony wanted to be the man in the moon and count all the stars. So the next night when he said goodnight, he wished with all his might to be the man in the moon. But to his surprise, he became a star. There's only one man allowed in the moon, and that's me. Why do you want to be me? Because you're the glowiest thing in the sky. Sometimes you're so bright I can read by your light in the middle of the night. All I can do is sit here and shine. You down there can run and jump and hug your mom and play with friends and do so many wonderful things. You wouldn't like it here. Be yourself. Everyone else is taken. A famous poet said that. His name was Oscar Wilde. He used to wave to me from down there. Now, get ready. Hang on. And the star fell through the sky, down, 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 and took Anthony home. I guess I'll be me.
Cynthia, what a trip. I've got to put it right there on top of my list. I'm sure it will be the highlight of 2019. I agree, Morris. I never would have imagined this could be so spectacular. And we ended up here totally by chance. Fate. Fate does have its way of working its wonders. No, I don't know if fate gets the credit for terrible air pollution. That's a strange way to put it, Cynthia, but you're right. When we heard about the terrible air quality in Thailand, canceling our trip there was the only thing that made sense. We couldn't take risks with that type of thing at our age. Certainly not, Morris. And if we had gone to Thailand, we would have missed the wonderful things we did there. The incredible mosques, the gorgeous countryside, that oceanfront castle where Orson Welles shot Macbeth, and that exciting camel ride across the Sahara. Isn't Morocco amazing? Oh, Cynthia, and the wonderful music and dances at the banquet our tour arranger provided for us. What a night that was. Oh, yes, Morris. Oh, yes. And I remember, you couldn't take your eyes off of her, could you? But what about the other great thing about the tour? Meeting all the others on our bus. What a pleasant bunch. All of them from the U.S. I wish we weren't the only ones on today's direct flight back to JFK. Well, for me, the most exciting thing of all, you know what that was. All of the exciting shopping at the Casbahs in Marrakesh, Guazirat, Rabat. And such bargains and items we can't get back at home. It was wonderful. Ah, but Cynthia, we saved the best for last. Rick's American Cafe. What a wonderful way to close off our tour. And today, this marketplace in Casablanca. I could shop here all day, Morris. It's gigantic. Cynthia, but I find bargaining with the shopkeepers to be distressing. you never know if you've finally gotten the best possible price or not. But that's the fun part of it, Morris. It's a little game I like to play, throwing up my arms and walking away without buying and having the vendor chase after me with a lower price, which you never refuse, my dear. And I think we've just got enough room in our luggage for one of those sets of ceramic balls over there. If you just give me a minute, Cynthia, please, enough is enough. We've got to get back to the hotel. The taxi the tour guide ordered to take us to the airport will be arriving in our hotel in less than half an hour. We've got to get our luggage and check out. All right, Morris, all right. Maybe I can get a better deal at the duty-free shop in the airport. Yes, dear, of course. Such stuff as dreams are made of. So which way back to the hotel, Cynthia? Which way, Morris? You're asking me which way? I thought you were paying attention to where we were walking. Me? With my sense of direction? Cynthia? You expected me? Well, Morris, you know I was distracted by all the incredible number of vendors I was looking at. Just retrace our steps back to our steps. This place is a gigantic maze of alleyways. It's like a maze. We went around in circles. I thought you were watching where we were going. Well, let's look for the nearest exit to the main boulevard we came in. Exit. Exit. What exit? I can't see anything but more alleyways and vendors. How are we going to get out of here? Well, what are we going to do, Morris? We'll miss our ride to the airport. Well, if you hadn't dragged me into this, shopping, we've got an hour to kill. Let's do more shopping. That is not fair, Morris Applebaum. Don't blame your lousy sense of direction on me. Okay. Let's not fight. Let's go this way. No, that can't be right. Let's go that way. Look, there's a policeman over there. Right in front of the fruit stand. I'll ask him how to get out of this maze. Good idea, Morris. Good idea. Ask him where the best Western Oasis is. Well, what did he say? Can you believe he didn't speak a word of English? He kept on pointing to the men's room, which I will be needing any minute anyway. Forget about your leakage, Morris. We've got to find our way back to the hotel. We'll end up missing our flight altogether. I don't know what we're going to do. Are we walking closer to an exit or further away? This is impossible. It's going to cost us a fortune to book another flight. Oh, wait, Cynthia. Look over there. Look at those two. The way they dress, they must be American tourists like us. Let's go ask them the way out. Excuse me. Would you happen to know way back to the main street? You do? That way? Past the roasting goats? Oh, thank you. Hurry, Morris. Look, down there, it's our hotel. There's our cab driver, and he doesn't look happy. I know what I'll do to cheer him up. I'll tell him at least he doesn't have to wear a mask all day like they do in Bangkok. That's right, Cynthia. And before you know it, we'll be on our way back to the good old New York City. And thank goodness, we'll never have to worry about a thing like wearing masks back home. No, none of us ever would have guessed, would we?
You see these hands? They've been around for almost 70 years. Yeah, crooked, swollen knuckles. They actually hurt. Today, these hands carry grocery or wash dishes every day and hit the letters on the keyboard. But when they were 5 years old, didn't do any of that. Their hands are living on a second floor tenement building on Lower East Side and loves to press his hand against on a windowsill, look outside to see people come in and out of Texas Market and count how many cars go by. Favorite pastime is this. At 7 years old, the hands were taken on a plane all the way landed in Hong Kong. There, the hands made a lot of friends with hands on the other side of the world.
Sue, make.
Sang, at age 10, the hands perform magic. Check this out. At age 11, the hand suddenly returned to New York. The hands went through a very dark period. At 13, the clouds lifted and the hands started to cope for the brothers and sisters. At 16, the hands had an argument with their fathers over who pays for this guitar. The answer is blowing. In the same year, the hands learned to dance. There were 10 pairs of hands dancing all together. The hands would never been this happy, but every year other hands dropped out. But the hands wanted to dance more and more and look out for teachers to learn more dances everywhere. At 28, the hands start to perform everywhere and start teaching other hands to dance. Hands of different size colors. And fly back and forth to China to study more dances. Yes, I'll come right over. Sorry, guys, I have to go. I promised some hands I would teach them a new dance in the park. I'm really sorry. Okay, until next time. Bye.
Hello, everyone. That was wonderful. Would all the artists please turn on their video and unmute themselves so that we can see you? I'm just going to repeat who the artists were in order. I got a request that they get mentioned. So, Jesse, Nora, Maria, Dolores, Megan, Toby, Allan, and Margaret. I'm going to ask each artist just a little question. And so we're going to just go in order. We'll start with Jesse. Hi, Jesse.
Hi, Carl.
So Jesse, what did you discover in the process of making this piece in terms of yourself and the work and your craft?
Well, I learned that I have the skill to write and to create the film / video via visual theater means.
Yeah, and you edited the whole thing yourself, which is really impressive.
Yes, everything I did by myself, that's correct.
Okay, I'm gonna, well, thank you, Jesse. Susan, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Great. So Susan, I'll ask you the same question. What did you discover in the process of making this piece in terms of yourself and your work and your craft?
Well, this was totally different than our usual work where we used actors and in a stage performance. So you had to really rely on showing more than telling. Mm-hmm. And I think the use of photography and the use of artwork and sounds were, you know, pivotal and more important than anything. And facial expressions. And I think you have to really concentrate on the artwork and the expressions, like in my piece, for example, Doris had to show how in love she was. I wanted to make sure the face was shown. And so you're really showing more than telling. So I learned that, and it was a different dynamic altogether. And you know, for example, and even Maria's great piece with the dog boy. I mean, boy, you know, what a frisky guy, but you had to look at the dog's face too. So it's all, I think the visual was, foremost here. And sort of like silent films, you know?
Mm-hmm. You know? I did notice that you all brought, you actually had more characters in your, like you have accents, and it was cool that you actually brought character to the language.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. I'm not around those little kids, so it's hard to, do the kids' voices if you don't see them all the time. So, yeah, I wanted to make a little variation there. So they were different characters to give some differential, you know, to the characters. But anyway, it was a great experience, and thank you, teachers.
Oh, wonderful. Pleasure. Maria, you're up next.
Oh, yes, Carla, yes. I was inspired by the theme childhood fascinations, and the first thing that came to my mind was my favorite childhood book, Alice in Wonderland, which I was obsessed with, and I read over and over again out loud, and I decided to reread it, and then it somehow took me back to my childhood summers in the country, and what a great place to be, you know, in the midst of a pandemic, reliving the days of riding my bicycle up and down hills and being a child and having all that freedom. And to quote Mark Twain, get a bicycle, you will not regret it if you live. I'd like to thank Dixon Place, of course, Concrete Temple Theater, Carla, Renee, and Eric for all of your help and inspiring me to take this journey back in time. And I look forward to our next adventure together. You know, thank you so much for your amazing help to put this together. We couldn't have done it without all of you. Thank you so much. Yes, thank you.
Toby? Oh, Megan, I'm sorry. Megan, you're up next.
Sure. I have to get my video is unable to start video. So I have to be able to, here we go. Now we got it.
Great. So what was the most inspiring or uplifting experience of this process of creating the piece that you showed?
Well, I was very inspired by Godzilla, the fairy Godzilla. When I was thinking about this piece, I was thinking about creatures or forces that inspire children. And I thought about fairy godmother. There's a cartoon about a fairy godfather who smokes cigars. And I was thinking fairy Godzilla came through. And it was an interesting creature. And he was supposed to stay upstage the whole time. But when I was filming before the dream sequence, he just came downstage and looked right in the camera and said, I have a message for the audience, right? It was just, he was a really interesting character. And I think it's really nice to know that if we forget who we really are or what our life's path is, that we just might have a tap dancing god fairy Godzilla visit us in a dream and remind us of what we're supposed to be doing in our lives. So I have a new friend now.
Thank you. Toby.
Hello.
There you are.
Fantastic. Wherever I should be, I'm going to answer any question you have for me.
Well, Toby, I'm going to ask you the same question I asked Jesse. What did you discover in the process of making this piece in terms of yourself, your work, or your craft?
Well, I have to tell you, this is not the first time that I've taken this class with you and with Renee and Eric. And I think you're just great, because this is really the first time that I struggled with really understanding how important the images are. The script is not enough. And I had a tough time this round because it took me a while to get for that to dawn on me. Once that happened, once I understood that, then the work started to move for me. Otherwise I was stuck for a while because I was just not grasping that. And now I understand it. And it's a wonderful medium. It's amazing. Without the images, the script would not have worked. Thank you. Thank you all for your help.
Well, thank you, Toby. Allan, where are you?
Here I am. You see me? I'm here.
Oh, great. So I'll ask you, what inspired your piece?
I was inspired by the irony of the situation, because as the piece showed, my wife and I really did go to Morocco. That picture of two people on a camel, that was my wife and myself. And the reason we didn't go to Thailand was because the air quality wasn't so great, so we couldn't go there. And here we are in the situation we've been here for the past year. So I thought of how ironic it was. We didn't want to go there because the quality wasn't quite good enough. Instead, we went somewhere else, which turned out to be spectacular. And so fate did play its own in our favor in one way. And in doing this piece, some of the photographs were mine that you saw, and some were from doing research on Google. And one of the things that inspired me was the incredible amount of photography I saw and artwork I saw out there on Google. And it sort of inspires you to think visually when you see what other people have achieved. And the other inspirational thing was, it's a constant reminder. One day we will be able to go back places and revisit the world. And just that memory was inspirational.
Lovely. Well, thank you.
So thanks everybody and who made this all possible. Carlos, Eric, Renee, and all my co-presenters.
Well, thank you. Margaret, where are you?
Yeah, I am. Can you see me? Can I see myself?
I see you now. Yes, yes.
Okay.
So Margaret, I'll ask you the same question. What inspired your piece?
You know, the last year or so, my fingers start to hurt. So no matter what I do, it hurts, right? Mm. Everything, washing dishes, carrying grocery, everything I do hurts. So it made me think of how much I appreciate my hands, that my hands really my whole life. Then when my fellow classmate talked about being on a bike, getting on a trip and things like that, I realized as a child, I didn't have a doll. I didn't play with dolls. I didn't get on the bike. I didn't go swimming. I didn't do any of that. So what did I do? And that's how we start realizing in during that time period, girls are not encouraged to do sports. So I'll do a lot of drum roll and handcrafts and embroidery, everything with hands. And eventually I had to cook for my family. And that's also hands. And in Chinese dance, a lot of hand gesture, a lot of holding props or saw. Then I realized how much I love using my hands, from drawing to do everything. And I felt the hands can represent our life, how we live our life. So that's how inspiration came from.
Lovely, yeah.
But well, thank you for the opportunity. It was really wonderful to listen to everyone's story and watching the development.
Yes, so. Yeah. Well, thank you, everyone. I'm not sure how, we want to try and open it up to the general audience just to let people applaud and everything. So maybe go to, maybe everyone should go to gallery view and then they can see all the audience. So the audience, let us see you for a moment. Is that okay, Mike?
Something, so yeah, folks can feel free now to go ahead and unmute themselves and turn their microphones on. And everyone's kind of chiming in. But
maybe we just wanted to.
So yeah, if folks feel inspired to share something from the audience, or someone from the audience is inspired to share something,
okay, they
can feel free to kind of go ahead and do that.
No.
Yeah, yeah. If anyone wants to, and thank you for all the little notes, the little messages you wrote, everybody.
I believed. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Oh, hi, I'm Roberta. I can't believe that those dolls were not real, that they didn't have lives and personalities. And the music, and I thought Maria's dog was real. This took me totally out of the pandemic and into poetry, music, and everything else, the visual. It was just... it was seamlessly done, you know. It just wasn't just stuck and pasted together. And it was as if the creators believed in their work so much themselves that it just came across unreally. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Roberta.
Okay.
It was a delight.
Thank you.
I didn't know what I was going to get, but everything was wonderful. Everything was so different, but it was just really well thought out and delightful. Keep up the good work, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I enjoyed everybody's creative.
Is Renee.
Hi, Katie. Thank you.
Thank you.
You know the dolls.
Yes, I know the dolls.
Congratulations, everybody. Awesome. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you. Thank you for attending. Thank you for coming to our show.
Thank you.
Have a good night. Be safe, everybody.
Congratulations.
Be safe, everybody. Be safe.
You too. Thank you, Jesse.
All of the pieces were wonderful and very creative. So thank you very much, everyone. Congratulations. Good job.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And Margaret, I want to say Happy New Year. Shen Nian Kuai Le, Margaret.
Happy New Year.
I love your hands. Me too. I have my fans. Yes, Margaret.
Lila.
Goomshi, goomshi.
Aw, nice.
So thank you, Servage. Thank you, Sarah.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations, everyone.
Congratulations, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Till we meet again.
Thank you, Maria.
Wise.
Keep up the good work.
If I could say something, you guys all put me out of work. I used to act in some of the shows.
Hey, Leo.
So thanks. And then I realized that nobody needs me anymore. But it's nice to see and hear your work, having worked with some of you, most of you before at Dixon Place. And it's funny thing about Zoom really welcomes this kind of performance. It really lets you just suspend rather than just hearing script of somebody sitting on a couch doing a monologue or something like this. This really brought it to life. So that was really nice. And the thing about going back to childhood is you realize how profound how your thoughts were very profound and how much freedom you had to think and dream and all that stuff. So it's a really good place to go. And I think you all went to good places there in all your work. So I really appreciate it. Nice to see you.
Likewise.
Good job.
Good to see you.
Miss you.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Thank you for coming.
Yes, thank you, everyone.
Again.
Hi, Ziamara.
It was just a marvelous evening.
Oh, hi, Ziamara.
Hi.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Bye,
thank Siri. You.
Hi, Ziamara.
Hi.
Love you guys so much. I'm so proud of you.
Thank you so much for such an entertaining evening. It was so lovely, and I totally enjoyed it. And I'd like to give a shout out to Toby, whose birthday it is today.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you, Toby.
Bye, everybody. Have a good night.
Bye, Mara.
Thank you so much.
Something to sort of end it. And
Yes. That's right. Okay.
Bye, guys. It was wonderful.
Thank you, everyone.
Miss you, Margaret.
And we'll see you all again soon.
Yeah. Let you know when the next one is.
Okay.
Summertime.
Thank you so much for everything.
We're not rushing you. No pressure.
Get started. Start working now.
Yesterday.
Okay.
Have a good weekend.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so
have
much.
A lovely Bye. Weekend. Keep safe. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Have a good night.
Bye-bye.
Good night.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Kim. I'll talk to you later.
Okay. Thank you, Margaret. I love this oil of your hands. I love it. Yes. Every time I think about you, we have our hands.
Thank you, Ellie.
Thank you, Ellie. Thank you, Ellie.
Oh. Yes, hi. Oh, God, so great. Thank you, everybody. Wow, what a great show.
Thank you.
Oh, my God, I was so impressed. I got goosebumps.
Oh.
Oh, my God, it was so good. What a great job.
Thank
Thank you. All
the pieces were terrific. Carlo and Renee and Eric, you just did amazing, amazing job, as always.
Well, thank you. For the opportunity.
Woo! Thank you.
Okay. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Bye. 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 Bye.
Go ahead, Mike, and turn us off.
I can't. It's just soaking it up. This is lovely.
Happy New Year. It's coming up. Happy Chinese New Year.
Oh, yeah. Everybody. Okay.
Hey, Margaret.
Yes?
All right.
Happy Chinese New Year.
Happy New Year to you, too.
All right, one last goodbye from everyone.
All right.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.